Hey guys, welcome to this session by Intellipaat. So if I had to ask you, which deep learning technique would you choose for computer vision of the plethora of options out there, which one would you go for? Well, for a lot of folks and myself, we would choose a convolutional neural network. So what exactly is a convolutional neural network and why is it so popular? Well, today's session is just about that. So we'll start off by understanding what exactly are convolutional neural networks, and then we'll look at the different layers of CNNs. And then finally, we'll implement a CNN with Keras.
CNNs. Now, CNNs are actually a new kind of, but they are one of the most fascinating kind of architecture that you will ever learn in deep learning, especially in images. So till now, what we have done is we have just seen that, okay, we are connecting some neurons to other neurons and other neurons to other neurons. And this is something the information is getting passed. And if you remember the maths behind this, that we are just doing a affine, then we do some activation function. It means that we are bringing some non-linearity in the data, and then we are passing it through some activation function, and then we are finally giving it to the next layer. And then this chain is going on. Things are coming in, going out, coming in, going out, right? But how is this network helping the model to learn the key features, right? We learn this new and very interesting neural network architecture that is called CNN, or commonly known as the convolution neural network. So convolutional neural network, what will it will do is it is somewhat like a let's say if this is the image, original image, then to find out the features inside it, what you are going to do is you are going to take a smaller cube, you will take a small square, green square, and then you'll apply this, you'll put this green hair on the top, so it will somewhat cover like this, right? Then you will move this green spot to your right, right? Then one step down, so it will come like this, again right, then one step down, then again right, then one step down, again right, and then one step down. Eventually this small image, or what we call it as filter, will like run over this whole image, and it will learn the important features and the aspects of the image. Right, now how does this done? I'll show you a very intuitive example here. Wait for a second. I have this wonderful thing running for us, and this is called CNN. Let me make a new Jupyter notebook. See, this is somewhat what is happening inside your. So this green image that you are seeing right now, this is the big image, and the orange image that is moving is called the filter. So what you are doing is you are moving the filter on the image one by one. You're moving the filter by one by one. Now, when I say when you are moving this filter on the original image, what I mean is that you are doing a element wise multiplication on this image. And then you are summing up all the things. So if I stop this thing here, okay, it doesn't stop. If I put it there, how do you stop this? Yeah, I learned this art. Cool. I got this thing here. Okay. Just a sec. Just give me a second. Cool. I have this picture already with me. Control C. Okay. So ing src equal to. Okay. See this image right now. Right, you can see this image right now in front of your screens. Okay, I'll push it here. Okay, so this green thing, this green image, and whatever this big thing is written here, these big numbers 1 1 0 1 1 1 0 0 1 1 1 0 0 0 1 1 1, all these big numbers are what? These are, let's say, the pixel coordinates of the big image or the original image, right? And then imagine this small, this orange filter, where small red color me, you can see these things, these numbers 1 0 0 1 0 1 0 and 1 0 0 1 1 0 1. These small numbers are the filter. These are the numbers for the filter that is going to move over the image, right? Now when this thing is moving over this thing, it is doing a element wise, or you can say a scalar multiplication. Element wise 1 by 1 multiplication means that this 1 is multiplied by 1 called 1. 1 multiplied by 0 is 0. 1 plus 1 is 1. 0 plus 0 is 0. 1 plus 1 is 1. Then 1 plus 0 is 0. 0 plus 1, 0 plus 1, and then 1 is to 1. Right? And then you have one more. So all these numbers, first for this one, second for this one, third for this one, and fourth for this one. Sorry, this one. So these four, this number becomes 4, and you write here 4. Similarly, what you will do is you will shift the now this filter to a little bit of your right. Then you'll have the second one. If you move it to a little low, then it becomes your, see, low and down, it becomes 2 3 4, then 4 2 3 4. This is how your convoluted features are calculated. Everybody gets the idea? So now do you get the idea how this thing is coming? If you see this GIF a little more, once take your time, imagine how this thing is working. It goes on the right hand side 1 by 1. 1 is shifting, goes down, again 1 shifting, goes down. And this is how your final image is made. This pink image is your final image that is made. Again, I'll ask you, please take a small time to digest this thing. This is a little not tricky to understand, but one should pay more attention to this, how this thing is working and how is the thing going on. Because now I'll tell you what is happening when you are doing this thing. So what is happening is right now here is that just tell me this thing, that let's say if you are standing in front of something, right? And then, so how do you identify, how are your images identifying you as a body? I'll tell you. So there are pixel value that are changing at the border of your body, right? So let's say that you took you're standing in front of a white wall, a pure white wall, and then you're standing. How are you differentiated from a wall? Because if you open up the matrix of that image, if you open up the NumPy array of the image, you'll see that your body will contain a higher pixel value, and the white wall will contain 0 pixel values, right? Now, whenever your body to wall is there, whenever the boundary of your body is there, right? At that particular instance, your pixel values will be changing, right? Because your pixel value would be somewhat like 230, 235, and then suddenly the image of white will be 0, right? So whenever you will be running this filter over your image and then doing this multiplication, what will happen that it will larger up broaden up the areas. It will broaden up those border areas for you. I know it's not easy to understand, but don't worry, I'll show you things. I am putting his blog in your chat also, so that you can open up anytime and then see. But this is his blog actually. So if you come down here, what is happening here is, this is what the image looks like, right? We have already discussed this thing that 255 is sheer black and white is almost like zero, right? Now what is happening is, let's say this green was your image, this green thing was your image, and this orange one was your matrix, right? Was your filter, right? What you're going to do is, you're going to put this 3x3 image over this 5x5 image and then do a multiplication, right? Multiplication, say you will be getting a convoluted feature. Right, now if you understand this thing, okay, so first of all, you know this thing is called a filter. Sometimes we call it as a kernel also, this orange thing as a kernel or a filter also. Now see, imagine what you're doing is that you are, let's say this image was not made up of 0 and 1 only, but it was made up of 0 to 255. Now what would be happening is that the larger values, the values that are two, so imagine there are two numbers in front of you. One is called, let's say, 5, and another one is 230. Now if you multiply both the numbers with, let's say, 10, which one will become more larger? There are two numbers, 5 and another one is 230. 230 is the person you who are standing. This is your body pixel, right? But the white background will contain values from 0 to like 10 only, right? Because this is the white wall, a pure white wall. So let's say, even if we say that there are some tints and something, so the color density will be, or color pixel, let's say it's 5. And let's say you're multiplying the same with 10. So your 5 into 10 will be 50, but your 230 when multiplied by 10 will be 230. 2300. So what is going to happen is that we are going to do a matrix multiplication and then sum up all the things, and these are gathered here, right? All the things are gathered here in this area. Now you might say that what has happened if you have gathered larger values, and then there might be some lower values also, because if you are running this thing on a white border also, let's say if everything is 5 multiply by 10, everything is 50, right? Doesn't make sense. 50 ko you add up all, it will become the same value, right? Now I'll tell you how things change here. When you run this, let's say this was your original image. This deer was your original image. If I zoom in a little bit to show you, this was the image. If you see clearly on my screen, this was the, let's say, image, right? And when you do a filter of this identity filter, it will return you something like this. If you return this filter, it will return you something like this. If you return edge filter, this is something like this. If you return -1, -1, -1, this is called blur, sharpened blur, edge blur. Then you have box blur, Gaussian blur. So this will happen if you multiply your image with this filter, and you run this filter on your image with stride equal to 1. So your original image from here, this thing, this particular thing, this thing will change to these things, depending on which filter, through which filter you are multiplying it. Make sense? Now let's say if you are analyzing this thing, this image, what has happened here is that you can easily see that the animal's border are now created or sharpened here, right? You can more easily visualize the borders of the animal, right? Rather than with this original image at here, where the borders were not much, they were not much in the same group. Now you can easily do a spread out with just one convolution. And this is just one. We'll like replicate it like multiple times to get more value out of it. Make sense? Now you understand why we are doing this, running a filter over the image. Now, this depends that what are the values that you're using inside your filter. Your filter might do a blur of the image also, and it might do a sharpening of your image also. And this edge detection is the something that we want to do right now, that we are very much interested to know that what is the edge of that animal so that we can differentiate if it's a cat or a dog, right? And this is the perfect example how things are working for us. Correct? Everybody gets the idea? Cool. Now, once you have done this filter and you have got a very edgy image, now what you want to do is still on this edgy image, you want to capture the maximum values. So now imagine that what you have done is you have multiplied a larger number with a more larger number, right? So your smaller number will become smaller and the larger number will become more larger. And then also you are saying that you want to have the maximum values only. This step is called as the second step in our CNN network, and this is called max pooling. This is called as max pooling. The first thing was running a filter over your images, right? That you have already run successfully and you got everything out of your image. Next, what you're going to do is you are going to do this thing. Okay, again, sorry, one more thing to show you. Let's see. With different filters, you have different feature maps available to you. Let me zoom in so that you can see it more efficiently. Can you see it now? So what we are doing is we are trying to run a filter over this, and through different filters, you can see different images are coming out. Different outputs are coming out, right? Make sense? Cool. So what we are going to do is next, what we are okay. Now in this, one more thing I want to tell you is that you should have asked me this question, that in this particular GIF that we are seeing here, we are moving the orange filter with one step only. Like, see, one step it's going ahead, right? You might argue this to me that, okay, this is also arbitrary, right? We can move it to two steps also. And my answer would be yes. You can move it two steps, you can move it three steps. And if it's a very large image, you can move it like more steps, right? So it depends on the architecture of your image and the architecture of the filter that you are choosing, right? Now, when I say how many steps do you want to move, this is called a strides. What it is called? It is called strides. So in our case right now, the GIF that you're seeing, the stride is equal to one. When I say stride is equal to one, it means that you will be moving your image, the kernel, with one step ahead. From left to right, your kernel will be moving one step. And similarly for going down also. So it's if you see if you quietly observe that your kernel is shifting downwards with just one row only. It might have shifted to two rows also, right? But because you have set as strides as 1, 1, 1, 1 means that you will be shifting column to one, and to row also you'll be shifting one. Make sense to everyone? So till now what we have done is we have taken some arbitrary matrix called as the kernel matrix, right? Then we took some arbitrary values inside it also, some random values. Then we have taken this thing called strides. We are by default we are giving it at 1, 1. It means one row to the left and sorry, right, and one to the down, right? So we're cherishing all these things as of now. And then we have got out something that is called convoluted field feature, right? Now one thing is for sure, that your output is going to shrink from the original image, right? So originally, if you see in your example, your image was around 5x5. Now it has come into just 3x3, right? Let's move to the next stage where we have done this convolution. Now our next step would be to get more darker, I mean more edgy features out of it. So what we're going to do is after we have got this feature map here on the after once we have got this feature map on the left hand side, what we're trying to do is we'll again find out more maximum numbers out of it. So what I'll do somewhat like this. Let me show you where it is. This thing. So let's say on the left hand side that you're seeing is a convoluted filter. I mean, this is the thing that they have returned you after you have done your feature mapping, right? Or your mapping is done. You ran the filter over your image and this is done. And this is the output that you see on the left hand side. Now, again, what you will do is you will say that I will take a 2x2 ka square, right? I will take a 2x2 ka square and I'll pick up the maximum values that are present inside the image. So what is going to happen is currently your answer is in the shape of 4x4, right? And then 4x4, and let's say that you are making a 2x2 circle, and then you have to find the maximum value. So in the first 2x2, you find 6. In the 7, you have 8. In the 3rd, you have 3. And in the 4th, you have 4. Make sense? Even this max pooling thing has this size that is called 2, that you can see right now it's 2x2. And it has strides equal to 2. Why? Because you don't want to get the maximum number again and again. So let's say if you are taking this, once you have taken these values, you should move to the next thing, right? So let's say this was the first, this was your first filter of 2x2. And now you have strides of 2. It means it will shift to 2 rows and 2 columns. So this will be your next row column. Next question will be, who's the maximum? You'll say 8. So you can see all the values are transferred from 6, then 8, then 3, and then 4. Everybody gets the idea. So see, the max pool thing is nothing, but let's say if we go up again, till here, where you just got this new answer from your after you have run your filter over your image, this is called convoluted feature, right? Now this convoluted feature is actually nothing but an edgy photograph of your original photo, right? So it contains more edges, more clear edges, and more things, but they're still not much clear to you, right? So then you want, what do you want to say to the model is that, model, give me more heavier amount of images, give me the maximum number of pixels in a particular area. So you say okay. So what you're going to do is the final thing that you have here right now in the pink, 4 3 4 2 4 3 2 3 4, this thing is called a convoluted feature. Now you'll go down. Now once you have got this image, your second step is to take the image and run again a 2x2 filter over it, right? And then with the strides of 2, it means the next step is not one step, but two steps, right? So your first square will be 1156, right? This one, right? This one is the first square. How much is your total maximum number in this? 1156 is 6, right? So you give 6 here. Then your second, because it's the stride is 2, so your next square will become somewhat like this, 2478, right? Maximum thing is 8. 8 will come in. You have next thing as 3, 2, 2, 1, 2. Then your 3 is equal to 1. Sorry, 3 is not equal to 1, but 3 comes here, right? Then your fourth square, then this is a fourth square, 1034, which is the maximum value. 4. 4 is shifted here. Do you get the idea?
It's what I can understand is the matrix from the earlier picture, we are coming to 3x3 and then we are again going to 2x2 matrix.
Correct. So we are reducing the size of the image just to get the most important features out of the image. So we, let's say in our example, we had a 5x5 image. First we came down to 4x4 and now we have come down to 3x3 and then 2x2, right? So we are reducing all the noises from the data and we are picking up only those things which will be ultimately used for classification. Right?
Hello, Shiva. Yeah, what about the information lost over here? Means as we are choosing the maximum value, the convolution values of other pixels,
mm-hmm.
we are losing this information, right?
Very good question. Very good question. So see, this is called pooling. Yeah, correct. I'll try to answer this question. So see, this step is called pooling step. Now pooling steps are of multiple different types. So here we are interested in more in getting the curves or the edges of the object, right? So we want to get the shape of the accurate shape of the cat that is sitting there, right? We want to get the features deep inside it. So what we're trying to do is we are not wanting to get what is inside the cat, but how is the cat different from the background of inside that picture, right? Because we are not interested in the background. We are interested in the cat only. That's why we are picking up the maximum values that will be differentiating as a border image, right? And I'll show you this thing also. And you are very much right that, you know, sometimes you don't need the maximum value. So that's why this is the most used pooling, that is called a max pooling advertisement, that we are trying to have the maximum value. But you can have three different types of pooling right now. One is called max pooling, then next one is called average pooling, third one is called sum pooling. Now what is sum pooling is, rather than, you know, taking up the maximum value, you do the sum of this particular thing. So 5 plus 6 plus 1 plus 1 is almost like equal to 13. So you give 13 here. Then you have 7 plus 8 plus 2 plus 4, that's equal to 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. You keep it here. And then similarly for all the things, you can do a sum. Sometimes people do an average also, but the most prominent result giving is the max one. And you can imagine yourself also, if you close your eyes, just see this, how is this image transformed? You'll get out the whole idea, right? So if you see this image, let's say this was the image of the building, right? If you closely see that, what was the output of when you run this convolution, that you get all the edges of the building, right? The edges of the building are now more prominent to you. Now imagine that you are taking the maximum values out of it. So it becomes, you are losing all the white information. You have just the black information, right?
Yes.
So see, now let's now again wrap up all these things, and these are the two main examples that you should understand at the first stage. One is the convolution. Convolution means that you are running some random value of filter over your original image, doing element multiplication, and then adding those things, and then having a convoluted filter. And over that convoluted filter, run a pooling kind of object. So you can have a max pooling where you're picking up the maximum values. You can have an average pooling where you're doing the pooling, where you're doing the average of the particular pool, or you can have the sum pooling where you're trying to do the sum of that pooling thing, right? But now between these are the two major steps in convolution, CNN terminology, right? But in between these two steps, there is a lot of thing that happens, right? So let's zoom out of this. And then let's try to cover them one by one, what we have missed till now. So see, whenever you're running this thing that you're seeing on your screen, this filter, whenever you're running, you will never run a single filter on your image. This is what CNN is. You will run multiple filters with multiple different values. And that thing is known as the depth of the CNN. So whenever you will say that from keras.layers import CNN, right, or conf2d. So actually the name in the keras library for this particular layer is called conv2d, C-O-N-V for convolution, C-O-N-V and then 2D. So it means that you are using convolution neural network for 2D images, right? So what you will do is, at that instance, it will ask you that how many filters do you want to run on your image? How many random filters do you want to run? That is called the depth of the filter, right? Now imagine this photo here that you're seeing here is, this is a image of a boat that is standing somewhere near the deck, and you can see water and some grass. Now what it is that right now you have a depth of 3. It means 3 different filters will run on this image and they will produce 3 different convoluted images. Did I make sense here? imagine that this thing is called as the depth of the convolution. Now, depth of the convolution means that right now, till this, before this example, we were running only one convolution, right? We were running only one filter over the image and we were getting only one output of that image, right? Now, what the model is saying that we will not run one, but we will run multiple. So in this example that you're seeing in front of your images, right, in your screens right now, where this, you have a boat inside, where you have a boat near the surface of the earth, you are running three different filters, and for running three different filters, you will get three different convoluted features, right? So you cannot control the value that what is going inside the, what is the value of those filters, but yes, you have to definitely tell the model that I want to take these many number of filters, because this will increase the depth of your model, right? So you will say, let's say I want to take 25 different depth of the model, or I want to take 1,000 depth, you know, for the first image. I want to have 1,000 different convolution filters, because eventually their size is decreasing. If you see closely, if you remember the GIF, the height and width of the image is going to decrease, right? But the depth is going to increase. So earlier, let's say if the image was of 1D, sorry, of with one channel, now it is going to convert it into three channel image, because you have run three filters on it. Let's say you ran 500 filters. So for one image, you will have 500 different outputs, right? So see, why we are increasing the depth is because, see, ultimately, the model needs to get some or the other, final decision thing. See, ultimately, the decision is taken by the last layer, right? And you remember that you have to ultimately mold your model to take to the dense layer. And you remember the dense layer are nothing but a single column rows, right? So when I say dense 1024, it means that this is a one column, but 1024 different 1024 different rows are there standing. So you can imagine 1024 blocks one over the above, right? So you have to somehow converge your model to have, so you're converging your 2D image, which has height and depth, and you want to convert it into a depth only thing, right? So let's say that your image was somewhat here, like 50 cross 50 image. So what you're eventually doing is, whenever you run a convolution filter, you're reducing its size to, let's say, 35 cross 35. But when that image is converted into 35 cross 35, you're increasing the depth of it, because you're not running single convolution filter, because you're running, let's say, 10. So if the original size was 50 cross 50, now it was converted into 35 into 35 into 10, right? When you will run more, it will convert it into, let's say, 15 into 15 into 100, right? And then eventually you will be having only 1 cross 1 cross 100. What is happening is, rather than, you know, running one convolution filter and having only one answer to the model, what we are doing is we are running 10 and hundreds of filters, so that eventually we are, like, in the end, we are clubbing them all, so that we can. So if you have done ML, you must have heard of this thing called ensembling of all the models, right? So let's say that you don't want to trust only one model, but you build three different models and then you club all these models. This is what is happening here also. We are not running only one filter, but we are running 100 different filters, and then at the end we are clubbing all their results, right? Let me just scroll it up. So when I say filter or feature, I mean this thing, this small yellow thing that is not known to us. This is the random matrix that we know. So your question, I totally understand your question. First, to answer the question is that, okay, that you are saying, right, that you, if you already know that if you can get an edge detection through this -1, -1, -1, -8, -1, then why can't I directly use this, right? But this one is only working on this image, right? Other images might have different convolution, because this image was very symmetrically designed. That's why you were able to do this with the -1 and 8 combination, right? But let's say your image is a little tricky one, where the polar bear is standing in front of a white image only. So everything is white. At that particular instance, your convolution filter will be something else, right? And now coming to a second question, that are the random convolution that we are choosing, is that correct or not? who will tell this thing, right? So what will happen is that when you are doing a convolution, you will have some output, then again you do some convolution, then your output, and at the end the model will try to predict out something, either cat or dog, right? But then your y actual is standing in front of you also, because in the training data set you give the y labels also. So your training label is also there. Whenever it will predict out something, let's say it predicts out the probability 0.60 for the cat, but it is actually a cat only. So your model will say, bro, you are doing good. You are doing good that you are saying this is 0.64, but no, you are not saying it totally correct. This is actually a 100% cat. So what you do is you go back, right? Go back and increase your probability. Try to increase your probability by 0.4% so that our error is minimized. Currently, we are having an error of 0.4. So go and reduce this error by 0.4. Now the backpropagation guy will go and he will say, okay, wait. Now convolution filter, you three are combining, creating an error for us. So we are changing your results to this level so that you decrease the error. So eventually, whenever you're doing a feed forward and backward propagation, feed forward, backward, feedward, backward, you're ultimately converging your model to minimize the error and maximize your accuracy, right? So at that particular instance, you at the end, you know, when your model is converged to let's say saturated with no more error decreasing or no more accuracy increasing, at that particular instance, whatever convolution values you have, those are the perfect convolutions. And if you run them on your image, you'll see, okay, this is the perfect edgy thing, and then it is trying to classify. Okay, now coming back to the problem where we were, that if you are doing, let's say you have done the you have just ran a filter over your image, and your image is converted from this simple image to this more enhanced edgy image, right? Now if you go more thing out, so first thing that you were doing was that was called depth. Now what is depth? Depth means just that if you are running different types of convolution filters on our images, then you'll get different results, right? So if I'm saying I'm running a depth of 64, I mean I have 64 different features which I ran over my image and they gave me the output, right? Second thing is strides. Yes, strides, we already know strides is what? Strides is the step size. That how many jumps do you want your filter to move? So in the GIF, we were seeing that our model was shifting with one space, right? One space to the right, it was shifting. So that time it was stride equal to one, but if you do stride two, it means that which is going to jump, it is going to take two steps, right? Oh, then we have one of the important thing that is called padding. Now you might, if you see this thing right here. Okay, this is the dynamic one. This is it, right? Let's say if you are here and let's say that this is the first step, right? It has completed. Now let's say that you have a stride of two. Where will be the next stride position will be? Stride position will be almost somewhat here. This and this, right? So you will have an exact combination of how many. So can any one of you tell me right now that what will be the output shape? So if you are running a 5x5, if you have a 5x5 image, and if you are running a 3x3 filter with a stride 1x1, you have an output of 3x3, right? But now let's say if you have an image of 5x5, you are running a filter of 3x3 with strides of 2x2. What will be the output?
2x2 matrix.
Very good. It will be a 2x2 matrix. Take your time. Just do the imagination. Just move the filter in your mind, you'll get all the answers automatically, right? And if you want to create a formula out of it, it will be the original image size minus the convoluted image shape plus the strides. So 5 minus 3 plus 1 is 3, but if you have 5 minus 3 plus 2, it becomes 2. Everybody did the moved in their minds. Close your eyes, and then if you move this, you'll get the answer as 2 cross 2. I'll do it for you right now. So the original orange one, where it is the first one. Then second I have made is the second one. The third one will be somewhere here. Third one will be here. And then the fourth one will be here. And your second one was here. Right. So strides, you can. So this is what is called as the strides thing. You already know it. Okay, yeah. So we were talking about, we are talking about the padding part. Okay, now let's take an example that you again have a 5x5 image, 3x3 filter, but you have a stride of 3x3. What will happen right now? First is here. I can draw it for you. First will be this. The third one will be, the second one will be here. But at this particular instance, you have only 2 columns. Where is this third column? Right, so what you do is you fill it with zeros here. This is called zero padding. When you don't have enough number of columns to fill your things, what you fill it with zeros, so that now you can have a 3x3 padding. Similarly, if you go down, you will have this problem here also. You won't have an extra row. So what you will do is, again, you will go this, you'll fill zero in this, zero, zero, and zero. This thing is called padding. What is called? This is called zero padding. Right. Let's move to the next thing. This is called zero padding. Right. Now, once you have done all this, you know, you have run the feature with multiple depth and you have some padding or you have some strides, right? Then you'll get some output out of it, right? Similarly, like you got something here. Like 4, 3, 4, 2, 4, 3, and 2, 3, 4, right? This pink answer you'll get, right? You'll get an image. Now, if I say that, please run it through a relu. Now, if you remember relu, what was relu? Relu used to give you the answer as it is, if the number is greater than 0, right? But if the number is less than 0, it will convert everything to 0. So what we are trying to say is that if there is a positive number, let it go and fly. We don't care. But if something is negative, we are going to convert it to 0. So what will happen is, if you give a image, see, if this was your, if you can see clearly, let me zoom in. If you clearly see from here, you can see it right now. If you clearly see from here on the left hand side, this was the output from the feature. One of the output from the feature, and then you ran this relu thing. This is what has happened. Only non-negative values are there. All the negative values are gone. You can read there also. It was written black is equal to negative, white is equal to positive values. So all the whites are there. Blacks are all gone. Right? Now, once you have done the relu, then you have this thing called pooling that we were just talking about. Pooling is nothing but it is used for reducing the dimensions but retaining the most important features. And this is what we were talking about, that the pooling can be of different types: max, average, and sum. Read it here, these three lines. One of the best, I think this is the articles. He's a friend, that's why I'm bragging this, that this is the best article, but this is one of the best, right? And especially for, you know, new people who just started learning about deep learning, this is one of the best, because it is not using any kind of a jargon word. You know, otherwise people, they use like non-spatial locational background of the image, will not, and then you won't have any idea what is going on, right? So what is happening is, this is a 4x4 image. You take a 2x2 matrix over it. You do a max pooling. 6 is maximum, take 6. 8 is maximum, take 8. Here maximum is 3, here maximum is 4, take all these. So So what you've done is you take your original picture, you do some feature, you ran some filter, you got the convoluted filter, then you ran some relu, and then on the relu you ran a max pooling. So eventually what will happen, let's see if you ran the image on a max pooling, this is what will happen. I know this is making no sense to you, not to me also, but somehow this is making sense for the model. Model is able to understand, okay, this is dog, this is cat. Now I understand. But if you will see this thing for a very large image, right, you will understand these things also. Let's say if you have an image of 1000 x 1000 and then you're running this thing, you will definitely capture these things, that what it is doing is ultimately all these buildings are now reduced to a very lower level. This big image has been now reduced to this small image, right? And now if this would have been a high quality image, you could have easily seen that all these tall buildings are now reduced to a smaller level in the things. And we are reducing the dimensionality. Right. This is all what we do in convolution. At the end, we get this convolution and we get somewhat architecture like this. Now just pay attention for the last moment, right? This extreme left was your original image, right? Then you ran some filters on it. Let's say you ran 3 filters. So the size is 3 filters are here. Now out of one image, you can get 3 images, right? 3 different outputs for 3 different filters. Now on these filters, you ran a pooling. Now pooling, say you reduced the size of your image, right? Again, on this answer that you got from the pooling, you ran a convolution. Again, a convolution. Now let's say you already had 3 images. Now you ran 3 again. So 3 for each image will give you 9 images, right? So you'll have 9 images. Then again, you ran a max pool. Then again, you'll do pooling. So eventually what will happen is your image size, if it was 50 cross 50, this will end up to, let's say, 7 cross 7 or let's say 1 cross 1. But its depth will increase. Its depth will increase to a very large level. And this will ultimately convert it into a dense neural network. And this is what our idea is also.
Right. Let's import the first thing first. Import keras, our best friend. Then we have NumPy, our second best friend. As NV, import matplotlib.pyplot as PLD. Okay. I can remember these only as of now. Okay. So how many of you face problem in downloading the cat dog dataset? Eventually everyone should have this problem. And I told you the solution also. If you are interested to download cat dog dataset, then make sure that you are activating your Kaggle profile through your phone number also. Then only you will have this download button activated. Right? If not, it won't work. Let's go to keras.preprocessing.image and then we have image data generator. Then you have from keras. Okay, let's do the layer one and afterwards. And let's make the data generator is. Today, let's make 2 data generators, not one. One for validation and one for, but I don't have the images for both the 2. Okay. Let's split it accordingly. Okay. We'll do this. Okay. Image data generator, what does it take? It takes multiple things. How many things do you want to give? Let's say rotation range. Rotation range should be what? 40. I'm sorry, I have to see this thing with shift range. How much? 0.2. Then we have height shift 0.2. Right, we can what else do we have?
height, width, and then okay, we can do a flip also. Okay, horizontal flip, horizontal flip equal to true. We can move this GTM a little better. Okay. Then we have boom also, zone range. Let's do this as of now only. So our data generator is ready. Data gen is ready. You can see all the things by going here. It can tell you whatever things you have taken, it will do. I forgot to tell you one thing, that you know, if you remember in the previous sections when we were doing MNIST, what we were doing were, we were taking the whole image and then we were dividing it by 255. Why? Because we needed to normalize the image, right? Now, when you are using image data generator, you can do the same with just one thing. You just say rescale. And I think we forgot this thing last session. So I'm telling you, 1.255. So now what will happen? All your images will be through your will be multiplied through divided by 255, right? Again, your data generator is activated. See, data generator, right, saying it's a generator, so it will not give you all the values at once. It will give you the results in batches. And I think we discussed this last class also, where we read this, that generates batches of tensor images data with real-time augmentation. The data will be looped over in batches, right? Arguments, feature wise is boolean. You can go through all this. Next we are going to do is that we have made this generator here. Now what we can do is we can directly start with our modeling part, right? Would anyone like to help me in preparing the model? From keras dot model, import sequential, right? From keras dot layers, import conf2d. Today we're going to do conf2d, then max pool 2d, then we will use flatten, then we will use dense. What else should we use? That's it, right? And from keras dot activation, let's import activations. What kind of activation do we need? Relu and softmax, right? Then keras dot losses, maybe we'll use categorical cross entropy, right? And from keras dot optimizer, import sgd and rms prop. Okay, let's activate all these things. I think you're almost done. You've taken layers, you've taken activations, then you've taken losses, optimizers, nothing else, right? Let's make the model. And before we make the model, let me shift the stratus here and close this thing out. We get more space, right? Now let's make the model. Model is equal to sequential type of a model, right? Sequential type of model. Now let's pay a little bit attention that how do we make a model out here, right? Let me give some space and then okay. First of all, what I'll do is I will add a conv layer. I am not going to convert this image into a 1D image by doing a flattening. This time I am going to give the image as conv2D as it is. Now you remember that when we were running the convolution in practical, we had this 2D image. We were not doing it in flattening. We were not doing it row major or column major flattening, right? We took the image as it is, right? So you're going to take this image model.add convolution 2D. We're not going to do the flattening part. Now let's see that what does this conv2D takes place. Now conv2D first takes place filters. Okay, let's see what filters is. Then we have kernel size. Then we have strides. If you don't give strides, strides are by default 1x1. Then you have padding. Then you have data format, then you have dilation, before now after that all these are like default values, they already have some values. The only two things that it expects from you is one is the filters and another one is the kernel size. Now filters is nothing but it's the number of different types of filters that you want, random filters that you want to run on your image, right? And second is the kernel size. Now when you're making this filter, what should be the size of the particular, you know, filter that you are going to run on the image, right? So you're asking this the same. You'll be telling the Convol 2D keras that these are the number of filters that I will use. Let's say I use 64 filters and this should be the size. Let's see more deeper into this. Now one more important thing, when you're using this layer as the first layer in the model, provide the keyword input shape. So you have to make sure that you're providing the input shape, right? And your input shape is equal to 28 28 28 3, means that for 28 28 28 RGB pictures, right? And you have to make sure that your data format is equal to channel equal to last. It means that whenever you're specifying your dimension as 28 cross 28 cross 3, here 3 means that these are the number of channels. But if you are giving 3, 28, 28, make sure that you change your data format as channel first. So this used to happen a lot when there was this framework called Theano. So Theano has this had this problem, not problem, but it has its own functionality, that it used to take the images in the format of So Theano had this own format of having the channel first. Then TensorFlow came in, it said no, I want the channel at the last. So there was this conflict a lot. So now you have to specify, because keras used to support both TensorFlow and Theano backend. So it has this thing called data format where you can specify that you will be providing your channel first or channel last, right? But Theano ended in 2017. So 2017, yes. So you don't have to worry much about data format. Data format should be channel last only. I think all the major DLP frameworks are taking it in the last now. Okay, coming back to the filters. Now this filter, you are expected to enter an integer here. Now integer, it means that the dimensionality of the outer space, that is the number of the output filter in the convolution. It means, let's say if you give it numbers 32, it means there are 32 different filters, random filters that will run on the image and they will produce the convoluted image. Second is the kernel size, an integer or tuple list of integer 2, specifying the height and width of the 2D convoluted window. Can be single integer to specify the same value for all spatial dimensions. So it means, let's say if you give it this thing, kernel size is equal to 3, this means that you are trying to have a 3 cross 3 filter. Or if you're giving 3 cross 4, it means you want 3 rows and 4 columns as your kernel size, right? Strides is, again, you already know, so strides can be integer or tuple, same as above. If you don't specify, by default it is 1 cross 1, right? Then you have padding. I think we talked about padding also. Padding is either valid or same, right? It is saying that same is slightly inconsistent across backends with stride is equal to 1, as described here. So you should always take it as a valid one, works better. Then you have data format. These are all like numbers that are already predefined. You don't have to look much about it. But let's start with the convolution 2D that we have to make, right? Let's say that we want 32 images of 3 cross 3, right? Next, you have to give it as an input shape. Input shape, let's say that we are going to give 150 cross 150 cross 3. We are going to give, we have still not decided how our shapes of the input will look like, but we have decided that we'll go with 150 cross 150 cross 3. Now, once you have specified this convolution, you have to specify a activation function also, right? Either you can specify here only in this con thing, you can just go and say activation is equal to, or you can specify by again saying here model dot add
and then you can have a activation is equal to, okay, we have not gone here from, okay. So you can add an activation layer here also. I generally don't like this. I just add it here only. Activation, we love relu. We'll go with relu only. Relu is the most important thing. Okay. Now, does someone remember after convolution and then doing an activation, what was the next step that we used to do? No one? Okay. We used to have a max pool. Max pool again. Let's go. Max pool, what was max pool doing? Max pool was doing nothing, but it was bifurcating your image into parts that you specify and then picking up the maximum value out of it, right? So it's saying that your image, let's say the pool size is 2x2, it means that the image will start from the kernel size of 2x2, and then out of the four values, it is going to take the one which has the maximum number, right? But let's say we want to change this. How do you change this? You say pool size. Pool size is equal to, let's say we take it 2x2 only. Now this thing that we have written till these three lines, these two lines, which contain three specific operations. This thing is called as the chunk. Single chunk of convolution. These three steps. Which one is the one? One is conv, then you have activation, and then you have pooling. These three things together are called as the chunk of. Now what you can do is you can just copy paste these things, and then you can have more chunks. But this time you have to make sure that you're not using this input size, because input size should always be inside your first thing only. I'll increase this number to 64 here, or let's keep it 32 only. Again, I will copy this thing. Let's make three chunks because our data is not that much complex. Let's have 32, 34, 64, and then come here, and then you have model.compile, right? Compile me. You have loss is equal to categorical cross entropy. Let's find it in double quotes. Then you have optimizers. Let's use SGD only. This is the one that converges the fastest. Then you have matrix. Let's use accuracy, right? And then we'll do model.fit, but as of now we don't have any input outputs. Let's just make the model sit here only, right? Nothing much to do. So what we did actually here is we did nothing much. We just made three convolution filters. One is this 32. When we started this off, 32, we said 32 numbers of different so one, let imagine this one image will now become 32 images, but the size will drop due to max pooling, right? Again, these 32 images will now become into 32, but their size will decrease. Again, their height width will decrease. Now these 62 will become almost like what will they become? They'll become 64, so they become more, and their height width will again decrease a lot. One thing that I forgot to tell you is that this is not the end, right? Our end will be somewhere when the output will be only two units, right? This is not the output, right? We have to do a flatten here. Remember? Because ultimately, see, our answer will be in two words, right? Either zero or one, in two letters, right? So the output layer will only have two neurons, correct? Model.add, once is flattening. We have done the flattening, then we might use a dense layer. Dense layer, let's say we take 1024. Then let's add activation. Let me add it here only in this thing. Activation is equal to relu. Then let's decrease this by, let's say, 512. Again, have activation of relu. And then in the end, let's have the final well will have how many? Only two. Dense and two.
And this time the activation will be softmax. Right? So this will almost become like this, if you remember. So our model should almost look like this. Just a second. This. Does this look like the same? So first convolution, then pooling, then second convolution, then pooling, then imagine we have a third convolution also, then we have a fully connected dense layer, and then we are reducing the number of dense layers from 1024, then 5112, and then immediately 2. So this example has more, but this is somewhat like what we have an inspiration code, right? So I think we already have this data generator here. Let's add one data generator. Now what we have to do is that we have to make a train generator. Train gen is equal to data gen dot flow from directory, right? Flow from directory, where is our data? Our data is just behind this. Then we have cat dog cat. Yes, dog cat small. We have more generator small. You all know what should be the format of this folder. The format of this folder should where? Let me show you. These questions are coming to your mind, that how did I come to this number called 32, right? First of all, and then how did I take this kernel as 3x3, right? So one is the experience that, you know, slowly when you will be practicing more and more and more, what will happen is, now by seeing the image, by seeing your data, what is the dimension of your data, then seeing the complexity of the image, you will come to this number, how these numbers are coming. Secondly, let's say that, see, I am not a researcher. So what I generally do is I read papers. Now, if you read the paper of VGG, let's say if you read the one of the best models that are available for VGG, you will see that these models, my code is totally inspired from it only. Just a second. VGG, here it is. So if you go here and then you see, this is one of the VGG was written by Oxford people, where they made this. So if you see, this is how they have made the VGG model. Sequential modeling, then adding convolution 6433. And believe me, they have done more than thousands of iteration. And then they have come to these numbers, right? So I am doing nothing. I am just also following these people. And slowly, see, not only following these people, but when you will start your, you know, when you will start your modeling thing, when you will slowly start learning about these things, when you will be exploring, then you'll understand how these numbers vary. So let's say why I am taking 32 or 64. First of all, 32 and 64, why? Because there should be the number can be any number, but we generally prefer them to be in the order of 2 to the power. Because if you will see the maths behind this thing, if you see the maths behind the convolution, you'll get to know that, okay, all your calculations are done with the numbers in 2 to the power n, whatever the, where n can be stand from 1 to whatever the number is. And second thing is that to avoid any kind of a miscalculation, because sometimes, let's say your measurements are not working finally, it might be padded with zeros or ones, like we see, we generally saw in the padding, right? The padding can be a valid padding, or it can be a smooth padding. So depending and not having more, not having much wrong data inside our model, we generally try to have this thing in 2 to the power, right? Second is, these are the numbers of different types of numbers that we are having. Let's say your image is a normal image with not much information. And let's say you have 1,000 filters, right? First of all, your RAM will exhaust at a very high speed. Second, that you won't be able to extract much information. So let's take an example of, let's say that there is some task that needs to be done by some people, right? And the task is only for 3 people. Now, if you deploy 15 people out of there, the total contribution will be equal to what you have given, but individual contribution will be very less. So that will also happen if you increase the number, let's say the 64 to 1,500 something, then the total contribution will still be the same, but the individual contribution will get to really low number, right? You're getting what I'm trying to say here, things.
Yes,
now,
yes.
Second, you might also ask that I might reduce this number also. Let's say instead of 64, I might have taken 32 only. Now, if you would have taken 32, those 32, now imagine the same situation. The people, yeah, there's a job that needs to be done by 64 people. Now, if you're employing only 32, now the total contribution will now also be affected, right? The total answer that you want out of your job will also be not be equal to what you desired, right? So there should be a balance in this number. And believe me, deep learning models are not like that you sit one day, just write the code and then you present an answer is there. It's a process of reiteration. It's a process like somewhat like this. You start, it's like a circle, right? You have your deep learning model here and then you do multiple iterations. You have a deep learning model here and then you do the iterations again and again. You're changing your parameters. You have your parameters P here and then ultimately you have a Boolean here. Do you say that your accuracy, your error rate decreased or not? If yes, then you go out. If no, then you again go to the circle, change your parameter, again go up, right? Are you getting what I'm trying to say? Make sense? You will again go up, go to the DL paper, DL code, change your code. Now again, you'll check your error. Error, if it is correct, you will go out. Otherwise, again go in, change parameters, again go. So it's an iterative process, and iterations depend on the data, its quality, and the most important thing is differentiation. See, we are doing a very simple problem here, cat and dog, and it's quite easy to differentiate between these things, right? That you create a model that will differentiate between you for like cats and dogs, right? But if complex are there, then so this VGG model is one of the most complex models because it is catering 1,000 categories. 1,000 general categories ranging from little birds till like aeroplanes, bikes, motorcycles, human, homo sapiens, and apple, fruit, everything. So almost like 1,000 categories that are covering. And this model is like one of the best models. One of the best, I'm saying, because it's a very lightweight model and it is giving a very greater accuracy. Now, there are models where you have 100 layers of models. Those are also giving you accuracy, but those are not optimized models. Those are like very heavy models, like ResNet 101. So we have this VGG, and this is best in its nature. Okay. So jumping back to the thing. So we have data generator. We have to create a data generator out of data gen. We have given the folder. You all know how the folder looks like, right? LDIR is equal to, if I show you what is inside data generator small, then this is nothing but the two folders, category wise folders, right? These are category wise folders. Okay, so let's move back here again. So we have a data generator here already. We will say that please go to this directory, data generator small, and then flow these images from this directory, right? I'm also telling it that you should have a target size of 150. So whatever the size of the images, resize that image. Again, listen to me. I'm saying resize the image. Do not crop the image. This is not cropping, right? Say if your image was 1056 cross something, this is not getting cropped. This is resizing the image, right? So you are saying that you want to convert your image into this, then you have to give the batch size that how many images that you want to read, right? Let's say I want to read 32 images per batch. Now you remember we have 400 images for all the classes, for all the two classes. Now I am saying 32 batch size. 32 batch size means that if I divide 400 with 32, it will give me around 12. 12.5 or let's say 13. So this is always ceiling. If you remember, this is called ceiling, np dot sealed. So this is all, this will always be a 13 buckets we will have. So our epoch will show a count from 0 to 13, right? Make sense to everyone? Batch size 32, and then we have, then what do we have? We have data generator, then we have color mode, it's already RGB, then we have classes is equal to none. We need to keep it none. Then class mode is categorical. Yes, we want it categorical only. We have batch size of 32, it's by default. Shuffle equal to true. Yes, seed equal to none. We don't want seeding. We will save directory. No, we don't want to save. Nothing. We don't want to save. We want to just start the thing. It says that it found 401 images belonging to two classes, and that was correct. We had only two classes, right? After we have got our train gen ready, we should use the model dot fit, right? But no, here we will not. Okay, sorry, is it now visible? Cool. So fit will not work here. We will use fit transform. Model dot fit generator, sorry, not transform, generator. Model dot fit generator, you have to give it what? A train gen that you have just made. Next you have a step per epoch. Step per epoch is none by default, but this is what you think, right? Steps per epoch is what? That how many buckets will come here. So you get the idea, right? What was the number that we just calculated? That was 13. I'll tell you again how it came 13. So you have 401 images in total, right? And you are saying that you will have a batch size of 32. Batch size of 32 means that in each bucket you will have 32 images. Then how many buckets will you have? 12.53. Now bucket can be an integer only. So what you will do is you will do np.ceiling. It means you want the upper bound. Upper bound will be what? 13. So you will have 13 things. Or what you can do is, that is the most brilliant thing that all you always do is plus one. That gives you the idea, right? So what we are going to do is we can write here that steps per epoch will be, so one epoch is what? When all your images are gone from the model forward and backward once, that is one epoch. Now you have 400 images. You are only taking 32 once at a time. So your model will be taking 13 times each bucket of 32 images, and then it will cover 400. So your steps per epoch will be what? 32. Make sense? To everyone?
Yeah, sir.
Yep. Then you have epochs. Let's say 10 epochs only right now. I don't have much RAM in this, but okay. And then you can say verbose equal to one. Verbose equal to one means that you want the output to be printed. Yes, we want. You can have zero or one dependingly. And I have they have two also, if I remember. Yes, verbose is equal to 0, 1, 2. Zero is like totally silent. You don't want anything. One is with the progress bar, and two is with the one line each per one line per epoch. Right. Okay. Then you have these things called where is this class callbacks. Now this callback is a very good thing. I will let you know today only we'll cover this callback thing also, and we'll cover what is tensor board, right? How, when you are running a very large model, how do you see the losses and the accuracy of this, right? Similarly, you can have validation data. If you have validation data, you give your validation data where it is. Right, validation steps, how many steps do you want, and then you can further give this thing. We don't have much. We will say we will remove this thing. We will run this again and again.
and our model is started and my CPU has started heating up. Okay, let me stop it here. Sorry. I forgot to do one thing here, that you have to take this thing in some output history. Now we will start this. Sorry. See, I told you this number is going to be 13, right? Is everybody getting the idea? So we are saying that we want 10 epochs. That is a different story. But in each epoch, how many times it is going to run? 13 times. 13 times forward, backward, forward, backward, forward, backward, 13 times. And each forward, backward is taking how many images? 32 images. Now you can see your model is giving 54% accuracy, losses are decreasing 0.69. Oh, 70 increased, 69 decreasing again. Okay, this was a very bad line. We had accuracy decreased. Okay, the model is recovering slowly, slowly, slowly. Oh yes, increasing. Just two more steps and our modeling will be done. This is how we do. Now let me check one thing, because I think I did something. Because this is not what the accuracy I was expecting. The accuracy should be like, okay, so we have a data set also small one. If I give it the big one, let's try it. Then it should work better. Okay, let me run this again. Let me restart the model. Epochs are also less, so you might try to increase the epochs also. And I might need to do one more thing. I might need to increase the batch size. Now, can any one of you tell me how is the batch size affecting the model? One is that, okay, it is using the RAM, right? Because 128 images are now going inside the model. But what else it is doing?
My
batch
by...
size right now, I have changed my batch size from 32 to 128. What will this change? Okay, this is going to take a lot of time.
The number of to and fro that will change, right? in one cycle,
That is
one call.
one thing. Yeah, that is one thing that I totally understand that you say that this will change, right? But what else will also change?
More data to the model.
Correct. More data to the model, but not totally. See, the images are still 400 only.
Mm-hmm.
But your answer is somewhat correct. The images to the model will increase, but how? Because the total number of images are still 400, then how are the number of images increasing?
Feeding. We are feeding the images to the.
Correct. So let's say I give you this example. Let's say that there are two animals that are not known to you, right? I am giving you the images that this one is animal A and this one is animal B, right? Now, if I show you only one image at a time and then I ask you that, tell me who this thing is. Or another case is when I'm giving you 100 images and then I'm saying 50 are this, 50 are this. And then you see all those, okay, 50 animal A, 50 animal B. And then in which state you will be able to give, when I give you next image, in which state you will be give, you can give me better answer. Did you get my question? What I'm trying to ask, say? Okay, I'll come again. There are two scenarios. There are two unknown animals, right? And now you are the person and I'm asking you that you have to predict which animal it is, right? But before predicting, I will tell you this, that which animal is which by showing you a different picture to you. I have two boxes, right? First box may I open, and one case is that I only show you one image of each animal. One image of animal A and one image of animal B. And then I ask you that predict this third image.
Correct.
Right. And another case scenario is where I show you 100 images first. 50 of animal A and 50 of animal B.
Mm-hmm.
Then I give you some image to tell me that which animal it is. Which case is better? Which case is better to you?
Later one.
The later one, right? Where I show you more examples. This is correct. Also what is happening with the model also. So if you try to understand that, okay, let's say if you are taking a batch size of 32 and a batch size of 128. Now, when the images are going inside, what is actually happening? These are convoluted, then sent to dense. Then after dense, they are going to reducing their dense. And ultimately, they are giving some probability, right? Now, based on the probabilities, the model is saying that this is your error. And then based on their error, they are again coming back and then they are doing some differentiation, correct? Now imagine that you are showing your image only, let's say, 8 images. Now the model is trying to change the model is trying to change the deviations, your gradients, by seeing only 8 images. And let's say if only cats images are shown to you, then the model can get biased, right? And let's say now in the other case, we are giving more images. Now by seeing more images, it tries to be more generic in nature, right? Make sense? How things are differentiated? How is this thing like only giving 8 images and then across giving 120 images? And then based on those images, is someone, if it is bringing some change in itself, how it is going to change? Right?
Yeah, basically accuracy is increased.
Yeah, accuracy will increase. Correct. One thing is that accuracy will increase. But I am just worried about one thing, that okay, our accuracy is low. I understand this thing that this should be low because we have very less data. Okay, so I have some questions now. It says it's always better to have a big batch size. Yes, to make your model generic, I think your model should have a good batch size. But again, batch size is again not in your hand, because let's say you are having a less computational heavy machine, then your model won't take this much of images in one go, right? So you have to decide very wisely how much images can you handle in it, right? So it's a trade-off. You cannot even have a very less number, and then you cannot have a very large number also.
Until that, let me review the model again. Entropy, SGD. SGD is one of the fastest one to converge. So let's say if we use RMS prop with no delta. Let's see how it gives a number.
Image is ST or HD image does play any role, because SD image have more dense pixels.
Definitely, HD pixels are like more wider, sharpen HD. But again, you know, this is a problem also and a good thing also. Let's say you have a HD image, it will have more information. I agree, but more information will come with a more computational heavy resource, right? So now HD image, you have to like resize it to a normal level, right? So HD image will make no sense. But let's say you're not resizing, let's say you're keeping it as constant as it is, then you have to deal with the RAM resources, how easily your RAM is going to get exhausted. So you have to deal with that also. Let's say we are done. No, I don't think SGD is the best converger. It's converging best for us. SGD will converge best, but I want to show you one more thing here is that we have two classes right now, right? We could have done one more thing. We could have asked it here that we have. No, not here. Sorry. We could have come here and say that this is only one, and rather than saying that this is cross entropy, we could have said keras dot losses dot binary cross entropy, right? How I'm showing you that what is the difference between categorical and binomial. So what I'm saying is, why I took one only, because now my answer will be in 0 and 1. And why 0 and 1? Because if it's not a cat, it is a dog actually, right? So it's actually, it's so how I have converted two categorical problem into a binary problem. Binary problem is what? 0 or 1, right? Let's say 1 is dog, then 0 will eventually become not dog, and not dog in our case is cat. And this is one thing that you should always understand. Let's say that if your model is trying to predict three things, one is cat, dog and elephant, let's say, and let's say you give a image of giraffe here, right? Tell me what is going to happen when you're trying to predict this thing. You have trained your model on cat, dog and elephant, and now you're giving it an image of giraffe. What will it predict? 0 0 0. Okay, one answer is 0 0 0, that it will say 0 for each probability, right? Next answer, anybody else?
It might give some probability, some similarity with those animals.
Okay.
Maybe with cat will be less, dog will be somewhat means in mid, and elephant it is probably less.
Totally correct. See, this will, so one thing that you should always remember is that the sum of the probability for the three classes will be equal to
one.
At the softmax, we always use a softmax in the last layer. And what is the responsibility of softmax? That it will give you the, how many probabilities? It will give you the probabilities that much classes that you have. So if you have three classes, it will give you three probabilities, and the sum of all the probabilities will be equal to one. So 0 0 0 might, I mean, it will not be the answer. The answer will be that the model will say that, see, I know that the answer is not right, but because I'm not trained on this, and the elephant is not matching, it's not matching even to your dog, not cat, but
softmax, what it will try to do, even if it is giving very less accuracy for each, it will, based on the percentile, it will give you the probability, which will sum up to one. So Ankit was saying very correct that it might not give high probability for cat and dog, but it might give some probability for elephant and dog also. Right? And it might not cross 60 or above for each of any one of the category. So it might be like 30, 20 for cat, 30 for dog, and 30 for elephant. I mean the sum will be one. It will try to do somewhat like this. Making sense?
Yes.
So always remember, your model will always predict from only what you are trying to tell it. Right? And I will like to start with callbacks, because I have this sheet on 6 Jan where we did this history thing out here. History thing, we did all this plotting and all. So I think we should go with callbacks. That what are callbacks? Okay. Now callbacks is a very important thing, and it's a very thing in. Sorry, just give me a second. I'll be back. Just give me a minute. I'll be back. Sorry, I'm back. Okay. So we were talking about these callbacks, right? What are callbacks and how do they help? Okay. So a callback is actually a function that you can execute after every epoch is run. So let's say that your line is somewhat here, epoch here, and then you come here. Your accuracy, final accuracy is printed. Your validation accuracy is printed, and then whatever you want to do, you can do at this stage is called a callback. Again, this will be executed when your second epoch is completed with all the four batches. Then again at the third end after this, and similarly. So after each iteration of an epoch, if you want to run something, you get this thing inside your callbacks. Now, how do you get callbacks? Very easy. You just say from keras.callbacks import callback. See, callbacks is nothing but callback is that, let's say that after every epoch, once a epoch is run, and if you want to perform some operation after every epoch, you can call that function inside a callback. That's simple. So there are multiple things that you want to do after every epoch. Let's say you want to store the results, or let's say you are writing your own custom loss, or let's say you are writing your own custom optimizer, right? Or let's say you are decreasing your learning rate based on some particular parameters. So then you can write. I can show you. I wrote this code somewhat long time ago, and this contains a very good callback thing. Let me show you. So if I show you here, callbacks. Here I'm using model checkpoint and learning rate scheduler, right? So I'm using two things. One is called tensor, one is called model checkpointing, another one is called learning rate scheduler. Now what this model checkpointing is doing, this model checkpointing is saving the weights after every epoch. So I think someone from you just asked this question, that will it take the last step accuracy or loss. Let's say the last step accuracy is very large and you want the second last model. So what you can do is you can take the weight of the second last step epoch, right? And then you have the learning rate scheduler. So the question was that, let's say that the accuracy is not actually in the last step, is not good in the last step. It is good in the second last step. So what you can do is you can take the second last step ka weight, right? So model checkpointing will save each and every weight after each epoch. Second thing is what? That is learning rate scheduler. Now, sometimes you want to decrease or increase your learning rate based on the prediction accuracy, or let's say I am using this based on the V monitor that I'm using. I can show you that also. So you have to write your own custom function. So here, see, I have written my step decay function. What I'm doing here is that I am decreasing the learning rate based on the number of epochs it has done, right? So what I'm doing is, if the epoch has dropped to 3, so let's say after every drop, after every 3 epochs, I'm trying to drop my learning rate to 0.5, right? So for what generally, what I think the callback that you're confusing is with the web one, where we use it after async process, or you use it after a readout of a thing where you want to call back your afterward thing. That is a somewhat different thing that we are turning from here. So if you see the callback documentation, it says the apps. This is a base class. How do I tell you? Model dot compile. And if you say fit, and then you say callback, and if I show you callback, here it is. It's a list of keras.callback.callback instances, list of callback to be applied during training. That is it, simple thing. So what it is that after every epoch, if you want to run any kind of a function, any kind of a method, then you can specify them here in the callbacks, then they will be executed and they will be recorded in the tf.event files. Again, after the second epoch is completed, you run the callback. After third, you run the callback. After fourth, you run the callback function. So we were here at this thing that, let's say that you define your own custom step decay function. After you have done with the step decay, how do you call it? You make it your loss history, and when you are doing a dot fit, you call your callback here, right? So we'll do the same thing out here. What we'll do, we have this thing called tensor board. So if you see, I have imported this thing called, this one is not needed, from keras.callbacks import tensor board. So what I've taken is tensor board is, I'll show you what tensor board is, but let's first implement it at what tensor board is. Before you are doing your training, you have to do a tensor board is equal to tensor board. If it is in capital, it's a class. Class ko you have to instantiate. You have, let's say, log dir is equal to, let's say here only, or let's say that you want to make it as a logs. Okay. So what it will do, it will create a folder called logs in my current directory. And then it will store all the information there, right? What it will do, it will store all the information there only. And let's say I don't want to go in the logs folder. I just want to stay in my dot folder only. Stay wherever my Jupyter notebook is, just create the file there only, right? But you can specify wherever you want to go. Now, once you have done this, this will start this thing, tensor board. And then while you are in your fit generator, you will call the callbacks. Let it complete callbacks. And then it will be a list. List may you give your TB. Right. And let me increase this to 15 for now. Right. And let's start the model.fit again. Now, while we are doing this thing, what will happen is, let me show you. If you go in the files, you see here, there is this thing that has started building up, tf.event files. After this first epoch, you will see a new file here. Last modified. Okay, now you will see it up here. After first epoch. Okay, yes, you can see here. If I do a last modified above. Okay, it's not coming. Then you have to go down and let me show you. See if you can read this thing called here on the downside. I'm just marking it with the blue marker. This is called events.out.tf event file. So what it is generating is, the TensorFlow is generating its event file and they are stored here. Now, how can you open a tensor board? Very simple. Open up your console. Console, you go there in the console. Click on the console. Okay, this is Windows. This will take a little bit of time. Enter. And you have to just say tensor board. Tensor board is by default installed when you are installing TensorFlow also. So tensor board, tensor board hyphen hyphen log dir is equal to, or I can show you the help first. Sorry, board hyphen help. Okay, this is not good. This is the hardest thing. Okay. Okay, let me run it in a simple environment. Just a second. This is your Intellipaat working directory. We are in notebook 3. We are opening the CMD. Don't worry, I'm going to show you. Just a second. Let me open it up. So see what I ran, I just simply said tensor board, and this will start the tensor board inside the directory, right? Now once, okay, I did a mess. I should have specified this thing, but okay. First thing first, I should show you the help hyphen hyphen help, that what are the different parameters that you can give. There is one parameter that is called log dir that you have to definitely give, that where your logs are kept, right? Where your logs are kept inside which directory. Okay, this is taking a small time. Okay, so now they have changed it to helpful. It's not help. Okay, so these are the different flags that you can give. You can give a tag if you're running multiple. You can give port number, which port do you want to run. But the most important one is this hyphen hyphen log dir. This one is the one that is the most important that you have to give. There are multiple things that you can do with tensor board, but the most important is when you open tensor board and where you are. So I'm saying dot dot means wherever you are present, the log files are present there only. Let's go to our browser again, and in the browser, let's open up our localhost 6006. That is the by default port that we have. Takes time to run this thing. Let me check. Okay, so it runs on this thing. Change to. So here what you can see is the beautiful tensor board. It's loading. Does multiple tabs, and let's, if we see, our model is running on the 11th epoch. So you will have all the information till 10th epoch in this thing. So you can see the dashboard is here, and these are the loss and the accuracy function. These are the same numbers that you have here. So you have something that is greater than 7.1.0. And if we go back to our model and if we see what is the accuracy on the first epoch, that is 50.3. Sorry, this is the loss, 70.16. Sorry, it's correct. So it's showing you the accuracy on the top and losses at the below. So your loss was greater than 7.10. If you go on the mouse, if you put it somewhere, it will show you each and everything, right? You can smoothen it up more to see the exact accuracy number. If you're running larger numbers and you want to smoothen it up, then you can smoothen it up with here. Right? And this is for loss. Whatever different kind of, if you would have validation accuracy or validation loss, they would have also been plotted here. These are the two things that you can definitely see here. So you don't have to actually view this this thing here. So what you can do is that you can quickly come up here and you can say, okay, my step number 6 is the best. This is performing the best. I will take its weight. Right? Same here also for the 6th step, you had the lowest loss and the highest accuracy. So you'll say, I'll take this one. Right? Now, the most important thing is visualizing your model. So if you click on this graph button, you will see your model here, how it looks like. This is how your model is actually. So if you can zoom in, you can zoom in and see how these things are. First you had this convolution one, right? Then you had a max pooling, then con, then max pooling, then con, then max pooling. Then you had a flattened layer, then you had a dense layer, then again a dense layer. And then you had a matrix to identify what kind of a matrix it what kind of accuracy it is, and then you had the loss here. If you click on this loss here, you will be taken to the loss section. On the right, you can see that this is giving you all the things out here. You can also shift your model here, and then you can see this is how your zoomed in variable is. Sorry. So if you click on each thing, then you can have this. Let's say I click on this dense layer, then you have this thing on dense subnode 13th node. This is the 13th node. The input is coming from dense 4. That is absolutely right, because dense 4 is there, and then you have dense 5. And then the output is going in dense 6 for the matrix multiplication with 512 variables. And that is absolutely right, because in the first we had 1024, then we had 512. And then the output will be in the form of 7 tensors. Absolutely correct. If you go this thing and if you just do a model.history, it will model.summary, it will be the same. Right? These dimensions are the same that you see here. Then you have control dependencies. If you want to have more information on the graph, then you should definitely show this to client. These are like showing here. You can go anytime, you can go there. So why there are like two actually there is only one, but we are showing this as two because it's my mistake. I did this one thing. What I did was I actually ran this twice. I should have restarted the kernel and then I have done it, would have been only one, but I am stupid. I should have not done this. That's why it's showing two, otherwise it would have been only a one. And here you have all the things, you know, you can click on each and every sub node to see what is happening inside, in and out. Right, it has multiple things. You can even see images inside it. So right now we are not given, but if you would have given, you can see your things out there also. I'm so sorry, go back to graph. You have multiple things in here. You can download this graph also by clicking on this fit to screen, and then you could have download this also. Session, you can see multiple devices also. Let's say I have only one device, you could have multiple devices, and then also you could have taken trace inputs. So you want to see where your inputs are going till now. Let's say if I click on this, it will show me how is my input working for this particular section, right? Choose legends, whatever you want to have, right? It's a very, very useful thing. You will come to know more about this when you're training, you know, very large layer networks, when you're training good level of networks there. You know, I have a relative number. Relative number means what is the difference between the previous and the past one. So it's like a step function that you're doing. Then you have the step. Step is the exact one that the recording for each epoch, and relative is that you're trying to get the number from the previous one, how it is changing from the previous one. Yeah, this wall one also, wall is for time. So according to time, so again, I'm saying these are for like very big models that are running for like 5 days, 6 days. So you can convert them into time also, wall time. Then you have like 950 bit accuracy was here, 955 bit accuracy was here. Then, right? Make sense? But the only thing extra that you have to do, two things that extra that you have to do to bring tensor board was that first of all, that you have to tell the model that model, please, after every epoch, you have to save the things for me inside this filed call through this call callbacks. Ko you have given a list me you have given TV. TV is actually what? It's an instance of tensor board. And tensor board, how did you declare it? You declared it from keras.callbacks.tensorboard. Now, once you are done with this tensor board, how did you open the tensor board? Tensor board, you opened in the command prompt. You went to the folder where you are running this thing. And then you just write tensor board hyphen hyphen logdir. Let me write the command here also so that you get the idea. Tensor board hyphen hyphen logdir. And then wherever your dir is actually, so r was dot, wherever it was. If we would have been in logs, then you would have given logs, and then you would have changed it here also. Right, and then you start. By default, the port number is 600, 6006. This is the number where you, this is the port number. If it is used, it will increment by 7. It will increment by 1, so it will become 6007. You can specify it also while you are starting a tensor board by giving the parameter called hyphen hyphen port, right? These are all the things that we have today. So today we covered the most important thing was convolution. We learned about how convolution, we have to implement convolution with augmentation, right? Then we learned that last week that we saw this image. Today we implemented this image with the augmentation, and then we did this tensor board also. So I was saying that if you want to run your tensor board on some different port number, then you can give the port number when you are giving this command on the command prompt. So you can specify here like hyphen hyphen port is equal to 700, let's say 9 6009, or let's say 7009. So you can give it here. Tensor board has to do nothing with Jupyter notebook. Even if you are running it on a blank.py file, or if you are running it PyCharm, you are running it Spider, it doesn't make much difference. But the only thing that I always push pressurize is that you should do data science in Jupyter notebook, because the answer is available to you instantly. Some of my friends are like very against it. They use Spider. So it's a personal choice. You might use Spider, you might use what, but you can run Jupyter node tensor board wherever you want. Tensor board in itself is a very separate entity. So if you remember, we ran it through a command prompt. I ran something in the command prompt, and then it gave me this thing here, right? So if I show you the command prompt, see, this is the command prompt. I ran this whole command here, this thing till here, right? Tensor board hyphen hyphen logdir, and then it gave me that tensor board 1.8.0 is running at this address at port 6006. Press Ctrl C to quit. I just copied this thing from here, went back to my Chrome, and I just copy pasted this, and I run this. So this has to do nothing with your ID, whichever you want to use.